Welcome to our worship this Good Friday. Please stand. A reading from the prophet Isaiah. My servant will be successful. He will be respected, praised, and highly honored. Many will be shocked by him. His appearance will be so disfigured that he won't look like any other man. His looks will be so disfigured that he will hardly look like a human. He will cleanse many nations with his blood. Kings will shut their mouths because of him. They will see things that they had never been told. They will understand things that they had never heard. Who has believed our message? To whom has the Lord's power been revealed? He grew up in his presence like a young tree, like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we would make us look at him. He had nothing in his appearance that would make us desire him. He was despised and rejected by people. He was a man of sorrows, familiar with suffering. He was despised like one from whom people turn their faces, and we didn't consider him to be worth anything. He certainly has taken upon himself our suffering and carried our sorrows, but we thought that God had wounded him, beat him, and punished him. He was wounded for our rebellious acts. He was crushed for our sins. He was punished so that we could have peace, and we received the healing from his wounds. We have all strayed like sheep. Each one of us has turned to go his own way, and the Lord has laid all our sins on him. He was abused and punished, but he didn't open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. He was like a sheep that is silent when its wool is cut off. He didn't open his mouth. He was arrested, taken away, and judged. Who would have thought that he would be removed from the world? He was killed because of my people's rebellion. He was placed in a tomb with the wicked. He was put there with the rich when he died, though he had done nothing violent and had never spoken a lie. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him with suffering. When the Lord has made his life a sacrifice for our wrongdoings, he will see his descendants for many days. The will of the Lord will succeed through him. He will see and be satisfied because of his suffering. My righteous servant will acquit many people because of what he has learned through suffering. He will carry their sins as a burden. So I will give him a share among the mighty, and he will divide the prize with the strong, because he poured out his life in death and was counted with sinners. He carried the sins of many. He intercedes for those who are rebellious. You may be seated as we sing the hymn, The Power of the Cross.
Thank you.
confess our sins. Remember your mercy, Lord, and your steadfast love, for they are from of old. Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me, for the sake of your goodness, Lord. Heavenly Father, we confess that we have forgotten to fear, love, and trust in you above all things. Forgive us. Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have forgotten to reflect our faith in you in our thoughts, words, and deeds. Forgive us. Holy Spirit, we confess that we have forgotten that without your aid, we are helpless to change. Forgive us and renew in us clean hearts, so that we find delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God most holy, look with favor on this, your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed, be given over into the hands of the wicked, and suffer death upon the cross. Keep us always faithful to him, our only Savior, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. A reading from the book of Hebrews, chapter 10. Brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is his body, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. The word of our Lord.
Thank you.
Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 15. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. Then they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him. Dividing up his clothes, they cast lots to see what each would get. It was 9 a.m. when they crucified him. The written notice of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They crucified 2 rebels with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "So, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, come down from the cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. Let this Messiah, this King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe." Those crucified with him also heaped insults on him. Gospel of our Lord. We sing our hymn. Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 15. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." Someone ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Gospel of our Lord, please be seated. Well, children of God, our Savior, websites will talk about the greatest battles that have been fought in history, usually based upon the effect that they had on human history. They'll talk about Marathon, an ancient battle between the Persians and the Greeks that determined so much of the Western world, or the Battle of Hastings that set in place what would happen there to Britain, Yorktown, that ended the American Revolution, Stalingrad, their critical battle in World War II. But there has never been a battle that changed the history of this world more than the cross on Mount Calvary. This was the final battle, the big one. Jesus had come into this world for this purpose, to go to this battle. And your future, my future, and the future of everyone who has ever lived was hanging in the balance at this, the greatest battle ever fought. Imagine you were there in Jerusalem that Friday. At noontime, when the sun is the brightest, all of a sudden, it got dark, very dark. This was not an eclipse. Let me throw a little science at you. For you may have noticed this past weekend, there was a full moon. So that means that from our perspective, as the sun is here, the moon was over here so that you could see the whole round moon that way. But since Sunday, the moon has been continuing its orbit around the Earth, and so the light has been waning. And by August 8th, we're going to have a new moon, which means no light reflecting off the sun. You have to have a new moon in order to have an eclipse when the moon lines up exactly right between the sun and the Earth. But when the Passover took place, that always happened when there was a full moon. So there on Mount Calvary, this was not an eclipse. Although when we have an eclipse in another week, we might get a sense of what it was like. All of a sudden, in the middle of the day, it gets dark. The animals there get spooked, this eerie feeling. But in this case, on Good Friday, this was an intense darkness, like night. And it lasted for 3 hours. Ancient scholars claim that this darkness was experienced as far away as Egypt. The darkness came because of an execution. Crucifixion is a horrible way to put someone to death, to nail someone to the cross and leave them there. It could last for a couple of days, depending upon how weak the man was beforehand, how hot, how long this was. The executed criminal, his diaphragm just gets slower and slower and slower until he's asphyxiated. For 3 years prior to this point, Jesus, of course, had been going around healing people who were sick and preaching about God's love. That Sunday, crowds had welcomed him in there to Jerusalem as their king. And in fact, just a few hours before his execution, Jesus had affirmed that he was a king of a kingdom of truth. But now, God's warrior, God's king, was dying. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" The physical agony that Jesus suffered was horrendous. Of course, he'd already been overwhelmed the night before in the Garden of Gethsemane, overwhelmed by what the suffering was going to be coming upon him. And then he went through the night and through the morning with no sleep and nothing to eat. And then, of course, came the beatings, the crown of thorns pressed into his skull, the humiliation of having his clothes torn off, and then having his flesh ripped open by the flogging, and then having to bear the weight carrying his cross until he just collapsed there from exhaustion. And then what they do but take him, lay him out on top of the cross, nail him by his hands and his feet, hoist it up, stick the cross into its slot. And all the while, every step of the way,
people were mocking him. We might hear that story and say, how could anyone do such a thing to another human being? But Jesus withstood all this without complaint. In fact, he stopped to pray for the very people who were crucifying him. He looked down and saw his mother and made sure that she would be cared for by his friend John. And Jesus even could respond to the thief on the cross next to him, crying out in despair. Jesus could assure that man that he had life in heaven. And then there was the darkness. And that darkness shows us that this was not just a matter of pain and suffering. That darkness was God's reaction to the whole thing that was going on. The injustice of his only son being accused, being convicted, being sentenced and executed for what he hadn't done. The darkness, of course, also shows what God thinks about sin. All the sins of the world that have been laid upon his son, Jesus Christ. Now, when we hear that story, we could actually be grateful in a way for the darkness, because up until that time, the onlookers had felt free to mock Jesus all they wanted to. But when it got dark, that shut them up for the next 3 hours. But the darkness also left Jesus all alone. God's warrior, fighting the forces of hell. Satan, of course, hates Jesus. And Satan wanted nothing more than to get Jesus off track from his mission, to get him to stop trying to save mankind from our sins. We can imagine Satan's words there resonating in Jesus' despairing, weary mind. You can't do this. You can't save all of them. Them with all of their sins that they keep piling upon you. It's their whole history. Why would you want to save them when they keep turning against you? And of course, Jesus then had not only Satan attacking him, but he had the weight of the sins of billions and billions of people pressing down on him. All our attacks, all our selfish words and thoughts. And Jesus fought this battle and fought it alone. But throughout, he remained faithful. He held his ground for us. This is why he'd come to this earth. This is why he'd become a human being, so that he could take our place and then suffer and fight for us to pay for all of our sins. The worst part was the Father's anger vented on him. Again, at 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? Now, we know that the true God is one God. Three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and only one God. So this doesn't make sense to us. And it doesn't make sense that the Father, who is the source of eternal love, would turn his back upon his Son. It must have torn at the Father's heart to have all of his anger at sin vented upon his only begotten Son. But that's exactly what God the Father did. He turned his back. He put aside his love of his Son so that Jesus, our warrior, could win the battle for us, taking all of our sins and paying their price. Now, Jesus called him not Father, but my God. Not the intimate Father, but my God. Still a statement of faith, because he knew that God was his God. He knew that God was still in control, and he knew that he would be vindicated in the end, as prophesied by Isaiah and so many others. Yet he had to go through that sheer horror, the worst moment of his life. Isaiah had explained it. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. It was all because of us. You know, as you get older, I think you find that you may not recognize every sin that you commit, but you do realize that there are some things, there are some areas that are just wrong. Some areas that have to be changed. And so you work at trying to fix certain bad habits, whether it's a habit of anger, or laziness, or lust, or greed, or overindulging, or some other sin that we just caught ourselves into. The problem, though, is that we find that it's not just a habit. It's a much deeper problem. It's this contamination of sin that contaminates our whole existence. We need a bigger helper than we can be. We need a bigger warrior, one who can fight for us, one who can actually buy us back from our sin. And that is what we see hanging on the cross of Calvary. Satan attacked him relentlessly, but when the dust had settled, we hear his cry of victory. There in the darkness, with all that pain, Jesus was still following God the Father's plan written down in Scripture. So that Scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A soldier took a sponge, dipped it into his rotting wine, put it on a stick, held it to Jesus' lips, and then John tells us what happened. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." And after this cry, he gave up his spirit. Mark tells us that the temple curtain was torn in two from top to bottom. That curtain separated God's presence, God's most holy place, from the eye of any human being. But now the way to God had been opened up to everyone. There was no more sacrifices, no more bulls or rams or goats that had to be killed, no more need for any payment that could be possibly made, no more need for priests, no more need for all those restrictions that would keep God's Old Testament people separate from everyone else. God had opened up access to himself to all of mankind. Every tribe, nation, language, culture, every generation. And the separation between the Father and the Son was now over. Jesus could in the end say, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit," because God's anger had been spent. When Jesus said, "It is finished," that really summed it all up. The greatest battle of all time was over. Jesus had smashed Satan's head as God had promised many, many years ago to Adam and Eve. It was a knockout blow. The devil was still alive, but now he was simply hobbling, walking around, clearly defeated. Heaven now is our home. It is guaranteed. It is prepaid. There is nothing that you or I could pay in order to pay for our sins and win our way to heaven. And there's nothing that God has to pay anymore to win our salvation. The pain is all over. We are forgiven. So Jesus' work was done. He was exhausted, but everything was finished. It was time for him to leave. So he breathed his last and gave up his spirit. The soldiers, the priests, the governor, all those people, none of them could take his life from him. Jesus had to do it, and he did. Of his own free will, he gave his soul into his Father's hands, and we were saved. The greatest battle that was ever fought is over. It is finished. Amen. And the peace of God, which surpasses our understanding, guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ. Amen. We join in singing the hymn, "Sing My Tongue the Glorious Battle."
Thank you.
offering here at our church or go to our website to support our ministry. We continue with our responsive prayer. Heavenly Father, you are a just God who accepts nothing less than perfection. All too often we fail to realize how much our sins offend you. We forget that the wages of sin truly is death. We forget that there actually is a hell. Lead us to recognize the seriousness of our sinfulness. Lead us also to admit our inability to make things right with you.
Teach us to look to you as the only one who can make us just and right.
Today we are reminded not only of your justice, but also of your love. You did not spare your own son, but gave him as a ransom for each one of us. Comfort us with the knowledge of this great love. Give us the peace that the forgiveness of sins bring.
When we feel our guilt, point us to the cross, where our guilt was washed away in Jesus' blood.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for paying the debt that we could not pay. We thank you for coming to earth so that we could be with you forever in heaven.
For being our perfect substitute, we thank you, Lord Jesus.
Son of God, who offered up your body as an unblemished sacrifice for sin, and commended your spirit into the hands of your Father, teach us to cast the cares of this brief life on our Heavenly Father, and commit our bodies and souls to his love.
Give us the courage to face death, knowing that it is the gate to our home in heaven.
Hear us, Lord, as we offer our personal thanks for the forgiveness that you have given us, and for the home that you have won. This was in accordance with Jewish